Hello, everybody. My name is, for those of you who do not know me, my name is Ali Kujuri, and I'm an adjunct professor at this department and also one of the organizers of this lecture series. I would like to welcome you all to this fifth lecture in the semester and then 104th lecture in the series since 2006. I should also be thankful to Keysight Technologies for supporting this program, this in fact colloquium, and also our program since the beginning in 2006. Before I introduce our guest speaker for today, let me mention that, as you know, the pizza will come arrive at 5:30, and then you're welcome to have a piece, of course, and leave our speaker also a piece, of course. And then also, those of you who are taking the data networking class, let's meet at 6 o'clock in the room across the hall, so that if the others would like to talk to the speaker, they would have a chance to do so. The next lecture in the series will be on November the 15th. No, I'm sorry, this wrong. I think it's November 15th. Yeah, okay. And then the title of the talk is Negative Capacitance Transistor by Professor Saif Salahuddin. He comes from the ECE of the Berkeley University. The lecture for today, titled Overview of Distributed RF Microwave Filters and Design for RF Systems in the AWR Design Environment, is going to be presented by our guest speaker, Mr. Drew Fisher, who is a staff hardware engineer, RF Microwave R&D in National Instruments. Mr. Drew Fisher is an RF microwave hardware design engineer at National Instruments in Santa Rosa, California. He works on developing PXI, that is PCI extensions for instrumentation modules for the tech, test, and measurement industry. He received his bachelor's and master's degree in electrical engineering from California Polytechnic State University in San Luis Obispo. So here is Drew.
Hi, my name is Drew Fisher, as you've heard, and I graduated from Cal Poly San Luis Obispo about 4 years ago, and I hired directly into National Instruments. And I've been working there ever since in their RF and Microwave Design Center here in Santa Rosa, and I've been enjoying it a lot. And I hope to share with you some of the things that I've learned since I started working there regarding filter design. Can we switch over the slides?
Sorry about that.
So, as you mentioned, I'm going to be talking about high-frequency RF and microwave filter design. And with a specific focus on using one of our simulation software suites called AWR. So I'll be introducing you to a little bit about RF and microwave filters and what those are and what they look like in real systems. And I'll walk through a specific design example of a distributed bandpass filter. So what I'll do is I'm not going to be going so much into the math of how the filters work, but show you more of a practical example of how an engineer at a job would go through designing a specific filter using the tools given to them. I'll talk a little bit about using these filters on printed circuit board materials, and I'll do a second example of another type of filter to wrap it up. Feel free to interrupt me anytime during the presentation to ask questions. I'm fine with that. So if there's something you see you want to ask about, go ahead and raise your hand and let me know. So what are lumped and what are distributed element filters? So as some of you may be familiar, a filter is a structure that takes all frequencies in and only lets certain frequencies through, and it rejects the others. So it's a good way of kind of being a gatekeeper to your system and only letting certain things through. So in the case of lumped elements, that's basically just our fancy term for capacitors and inductors and resistors, these packaged components that represent a certain value. And here you can see a generic bandpass filter chained together with capacitors and inductors to form this filter structure. And you'll take whole courses on how to come up with the values required to create a certain filter response. Now, as you go higher in frequencies, there's another type of filter that you'll often see, and it's called distributed element filter, where you basically use these microstrip or strip line features. They're transmission lines on a printed circuit board. The transmission lines allow an RF signal to propagate from one point to another with basically copper on top of a circuit board material. And these transmission line features can be etched and shaped in certain ways to mimic the same response that lumped elements can achieve. So I'm going to talk to you about this type of filter, why we use it, and how you can go about designing those sorts of filters. So as I mentioned, distributed structures, you oftentimes sometimes hear them called printed structures. Here's a generic diagram of a microstrip on a substrate, so you can see a copper trace, and this is where your signal travels across the board. Here's a picture of a generic printed circuit board that I grabbed, and you can see its typical green material, and all the gray areas are printed copper on the board. And you can see a lot of squiggly lines and weird looking things. Those are our distributed elements forming our distributed element filters. So that's what we're talking about today. We'll talk a little bit about the design of these and how they work. So if you have two types of filters, how do you know which one to use? Well, you'll notice that at higher frequencies, lumped element filters exhibit increasingly impractical values. So here I just generated some very basic fifth order lumped element filters with a center frequency of 10 gigahertz. So what we end up getting is required component values that are very small. So something like a minimum capacitance of 15 femtofarads, that's 10 to the minus 15th farads. And you'll be hard pressed sometimes to find a component that you can buy off the shelf that will have that amount of capacitance. So you'll find that sometimes the components that you need just don't exist. On the other hand, at lower frequencies, distributed element filters, those printed filters, they exhibit increasingly impractical dimensions at low frequencies. So a filter designed for 100 megahertz would have a resonator length requirement of 17.5 inches. You're not going to fit that on a printed circuit board. It's going to be too big. It's basically impossible and impractical. So you would never use a distributed filter for 100 megahertz. So the question is, when do we switch over from one to the other? Well, the good news for lumped element filter people is that high-quality surface mount components, which are basically the components that you buy that you place on the printed circuit board to realize the capacitors and inductors, as they are designed better and they have lower parasitic effects, you can use them to higher frequencies to design these filters. And also, as these components have better simulation models with them, you can account for these effects beforehand in simulations to have more successful lumped element designs. But as a general rule of thumb, I'd say you'd probably want to start considering which one you use between 1 or 2 gigahertz. That's when you'll start to see the transition between dimensions and impractical values beginning to occur. So as I mentioned, lumped element components, they have impracticalities that can come into play. So here is what we call a capacitor model. So in the center here, you see your capacitor. And when you think of a capacitor, that's all you generally think of. But there's all this other stuff hanging on it that we call parasitics. And it's basically results of how that capacitor is built. It has copper pads that you have to stick it onto a board with. They will have capacitances to ground. It has length to it, which will introduce a series inductance and some loss in a resistance. So all these components come together to make your capacitor not just a capacitor. Here's another similar model from a vendor called Coilcraft, and here's their inductor. You can see that they have a bunch of other components around it. And these are used to help model these effects so that when you try to use these components at higher frequencies, those effects can come into play. Here's a plot of the impedance versus frequency for this model. If it was just a plain old ideal inductor, it'd be this red curve. But here you see with these parasitics, we get this this self-resonance frequency. We call it self-resonance because the components inherent to itself cause it to have a non-ideality occur at a certain frequency. So this is not ideal when you're designing a filter at that frequency range. It's not going to be behaving just like an inductor. It's going to start behaving a little bit like something else. So as I mentioned, distributed filters and distributed structures are printed on printed circuit board material. They're etched on there with copper. So what are some of the advantages of using printed circuit board material that we can leverage? Well, one of them is low cost. Adding the filters to a printed circuit board that you're already going to make is essentially free. You don't have to buy components that cost a certain amount and put them on your board. You're already placing copper down, and it doesn't cost any more to change the shape of that copper. So you don't add cost by having these filters in there. You can also save board space on your board. So instead of having a bunch of inductors and capacitors taking up space on the top and bottom side of your board, sometimes you can actually embed these filters inside your board and free up the top and bottom sides to put additional components on. So all of a sudden, where you couldn't put capacitors and inductors inside the board before, now you can put your filter inside the board and free up the outside for other things. You also have the option of design customization. So you're not limited to the parts you can find and you can buy. Since you're defining the copper that's going to be etched onto your board to create these filter structures, you can make it at the center frequency that you want it to be. If you had to pick an off-the-shelf filter, you have to live with the frequencies that different vendors decided were common to purchase. Here you can pick the characteristics that you want. So you have more freedom to adjust your filter's response based on what you want. So now let's make the jump from a distributed element filter, from a lumped element filter to a distributed element filter. So here's the filter we saw before, and here's a distributed bandpass filter. So I'm going to make a generalization of some of these correspondences. It's not perfect, but it'll give you the idea. So this length of copper, grounded on one end and open on the other, represents a parallel resonator, essentially. So this shape is representing that. This gap here, joining resonators together, is what I'm calling a coupling capacitor. It's a capacitive coupling between adjacent resonators. And here, this tap in and the corresponding tap out is an impedance transformation from your system network into the filter and then back out again. So this is generally what these components represent in the distributed domain. Now here's another weird looking filter that I'll go over a little bit later. This is a low pass filter, again made of squiggly lines and weird shapes. Those have correspondence to lumped element components again. These skinny traces that you see snaking along here, those actually represent series inductors. These big fans represent parallel capacitors. And this little thing hanging off the edge there is a series resonator. So we'll go through the design of this a little bit later, but essentially that's how you make the connection between a lumped element and a distributed element. So in the land of distributed filters, there are a lot of different types of distributed filters and ways that they are laid out to take advantage of, and each have their own set of advantages and disadvantages. So just to name a few, there's a lot out there, and they're continuing to come up with more variations of these in research today. We have stepped impedance low-pass filter, and there's a generic shape of what the copper would look like. We have distributed stub low-pass filter. Here's an edge-coupled bandpass filter, an interdigital bandpass filter, a comb-line bandpass filter, and a hairpin bandpass filter. So there's a lot of different ways you can realize the same kind of thing. I'll dive into a few of these to explain some of the advantages and disadvantages of them, and then we'll pick one to use for our design example. So as you can see, there's a lot of different varieties, and there's even more than what's shown here. And within the design environment that I'm going to introduce to you, called AWR, there's a nice little help file when you're going through your filter generation process that'll talk you through some of the different topologies that they can generate for you. And they'll talk about some of the aspects of these filters and some of the considerations. So as you're using any simulation software, it's important to take advantage of the help file that comes along with it, because it can really guide you through a lot of these sorts of things. So here I picked an edge-coupled bandpass filter to show you a little bit of what's happening here. Here we have these copper strips placed adjacent to each other with no connection, and the energy is essentially being coupled over to the next stage at a certain resonant frequency. The advantages of this filter is that there are no grounding, there's no ground required, no grounding vias. You'll see later why that is a good thing. And some of the disadvantages is that the spacing between the adjacent resonators can end up being quite narrow depending on the frequency and bandwidth you're designing for. So you'll find as you push things to higher frequency or you have higher demands of your filter, these spacings can become so tiny that it's impossible to build it in reality. So at that point, you may want to switch over to a different topology. These resonators are a half wavelength long. So they're longer than their quarter wavelength counterparts. So there are some of these filters that use quarter wavelength resonators, and as a result, they end up being a little more compact. And also this filter, and as with many distributed filters, has something called a spurious passband, starting at twice the center frequency. So I'm going to branch off a little bit and tell you what a spurious passband is. Sometimes it's called a reentrant mode. Distributed structures are periodic in nature, so as you rotate around the Smith chart, you're going to get repetitions for every rotation on that Smith chart where the same structure looks the same at a higher frequency. So what happens, an analogy for that would be aliasing. So in signal processing, you have a signal at a higher frequency and it'll alias down to look like the same frequency as before. And what happens here is you see that same phenomenon manifesting itself in this distributed structure. So here's a filter centered at 8 gigahertz, and here you see the reentrant mode coming up at 24 gigahertz. This is the nature of the periodic structure starting to look again like it did at 8 gigahertz, now at 24 gigahertz. So this is something to be aware of when you're designing your filters. If you care about rejection at this frequency, you have to take considerations to avoid things coming through. So here's another filter called a hairpin filter, and it's basically the edge-coupled filter I was showing you before, but it's wrapped around. These edge-coupled resonators are now folded, and it ends up making the filter more compact sometimes than the edge-coupled counterpart. Advantages, again, it doesn't require ground vias, and it can tend to be more compact than the edge-coupled filter. But same disadvantages as the edge-coupled filter. Half wavelength, it ends up being larger, and it has a spurious passband at twice the center frequency. Now here's an interdigital filter, which is a different type. This is a quarter wavelength type of filter, where we essentially short-circuit one end of the resonator to ground and leave the other end open, and this makes it a quarter wavelength resonator. And as a result, it ends up being more compact because it's a quarter wavelength instead of a half wavelength in terms of dimensions. And its spurious passband isn't at twice the second center frequency, it's now at three times the center frequency. So if you care about those responses at higher frequencies, they'll get pushed out even higher. Disadvantages is now you have to figure out a way to ground those endpoints. And that can be problematic depending on your design. So I'm going to pick one of those filters, and we're going to walk through a design example using the AWR design environment to show you how an engineer at a job would go about designing this. There's a lot of tools in our toolbox as engineers that we can use to design a filter, such as the filter types I was showing you. There's different advantages and disadvantages of each one. But there's also different simulation softwares you can use from different companies. But even within one company, one simulation software suite will have a lot of simulators within it that can do the job for you. So I'll show you what these different simulators offer and how they can be used to create a successful design. And there are also additional design tricks, which I won't go into now, but in the soft copy of the slides, you'll see additional information on that. So I'm going to introduce you a little bit about the simulation software, the AWR design environment. AWR is a part of National Instruments, the company I work for, and we generate a simulation software suite called AWR, which has within it several simulators that can be used to do the same thing, but to different degrees of accuracy. The first one is Microwave Office, where you basically model each circuit element and hook them together. And it's based on a closed form analysis of the circuit. So it knows how each of those subcircuits are supposed to behave mathematically. And then it chains those together and figures out the whole response of the circuit. Similar to a SPICE tool you would use. It knows a resistor and what it's supposed to do. But this is a little more advanced in that it can use distributed elements. As a result of these closed form equations, it's just solving a math problem really fast. So you end up with fast simulation times. Generally, when you press go, it's done in a second or less. So you can get your results right away. And because of the fast simulation time, you can usually do very quick optimization routines and on-the-fly tuning. But the problem with this and the downfall that you'll encounter when you use a simulator, even though it's a good starting point, is it oftentimes does not consider undefined circuit effects. It actually never considers an undefined circuit effect. Every effect that is simulated has to be defined. So if there's a coupling between one part of your circuit and another, you have to define that. And if you don't define it, it's not going to account for it. It's going to pretend like those pieces of the circuitry never saw each other. And that's when these other simulators come into play. The next step up from that in accuracy and simulation time is called axiom, which is what we call a 3D planar electromagnetic analysis. So it basically solves for the structure electromagnetically by breaking the problem down into smaller pieces, and it solves Maxwell's equations at each little piece for the electromagnetic analysis of the whole structure. As a result of that sort of computation, it's a longer simulation time. It's not almost instant. It could take 5 minutes to half an hour, depending on how complex your structure is. But it can end up being more accurate than your closed form simulators because it now will take into account unintended coupling effects between adjacent components and such effects like that. So it's good for analyzing planar structures, and you'll see as I show some pictures later. When I say a planar structure, I basically mean a structure that takes place in two dimensions generally. So like all the filters I was showing you, they're generally 2D structures. When you start to grow things in the third dimension and have things going in the Z direction, then you need to graduate to a higher level simulator, which we call analysts, which is a 3D finite element analysis, electromagnetic analysis simulator. And it basically does the same thing that axiom does, but it breaks it down in three-dimensional space. And it solves those equations everywhere. And it can account for even more potentially unintended consequences of coupling in your circuits. But it can sometimes have longer simulation time because now you're solving for more space in your simulation. But it can be more flexible in the type of structures you can simulate. You can basically throw anything in there if you have the 3D model for it. Say go, and it'll tell you how it's supposed to perform electromagnetically. So we're going to use these three tools for our example design today. So I'm going to show you a little bit of how the flow is going to work, and then I'll walk through these steps graphically with you. So we're going to use a tool within AWR called iFilter, which basically does the hard part for you, which is the math of the filters. So you'll learn in your filter classes, if you haven't taken them already, how to generate the components. And you could work through the math to generate those components, but it can be very time consuming, especially if you want to iterate on that. So this tool basically uses those tables and transformations that you learn in school, and it does it instantly for you so you can get your starting point. Then we'll use Microwave Office because it's a quick simulator to initially simulate the performance and tune it in because it goes fast. Then we'll take it into our 3D and 2.5D analysis tools to simulate its full effects, and we'll see if there are any changes from the closed-form models due to unintended effects. And what we'll do is we'll bring it back and forth between Microwave Office and Axiom and Analyst to iterate on the design until we get it honed in to where it needs to be. So as with any job, when you're given a task on a project, your manager will say, I need this designed with these sort of goals. So for our design example, I'm going to be the manager here and I'm going to say, well, I'm going to have these goals, and if we meet these goals, our filter design will be successful and we'll go on to build it. So we're going to fictitiously make up, we're going to have a center frequency of 8 gigahertz with 1 gigahertz of bandwidth. So that means the pass band is going to range from 7.5 to 8.5 gigahertz. We're going to shoot for having a return loss within the band of 15 dB or better and insertion loss of less than 3 dB. We're going to also want to make sure that we reject any signals within the second harmonic range, so twice the pass band, better than 60 dB. So you'll see these things in some plots later on, but we'll use this to gauge whether or not our design is working. Since we're designing on PCB, we have to pick our materials. And you have a lot of options out there to pick. And here I just have some generic materials A, B, C, and D from various vendors. And here you can see loss versus frequency. Some of them have less loss and some of them have more loss. But usually as you see, as materials get less lossy, they also get more expensive. So depending on your design, you need to weigh the advantages of how expensive is something and how well does it work. So we'll pick a material that we know we want to use for this design and move forward. Starting with eye filter, like I was mentioning before. It'll generate the basic filter components and do the math for you. So here's what eye filter looks like within the tool. We basically just type in the goals that we want to meet. And it says, is this what you want? Yeah, that's what I want. I pick the type of filter that I want, and it generates the design for me. It says, well, if you want this center frequency and this bandwidth, you're going to want a resonator such and such length. And it'll spit that out for you in the closed form models, and you'll be able to simulate it and see how does it look. Well, if it was all that easy, we could just stop there, but it never is just that easy. We'll find that the initial filter that it spits out will likely need tuning because it's only based on the mathematical models. There's a lot of other effects that happen in the circuit that aren't accounted for in the initial synthesis of the filter that you'll have to tune and account for. So optimization routines are very helpful in the fast simulators. So you set goals and you say, you can touch these aspects of the filter within these ranges, go through a bunch of iterations and tweak the performance until it meets my goals. So it's a really handy way of bringing a filter performance in. Sometimes if it's way off and you don't even know what you should adjust, you can use these things called tuning sliders, where you basically tag different dimensions of your filter to be tunable, and in real time you can slide those sliders up and down and see your filter response change or move around. So it helps build some intuition of how the filter is working and tells you what areas of your filter might be a problem if something is off. Here's what our filter looked like in Microwave Office, and you can see each little piece of that filter is broken down into a closed form model. So even the coupling between adjacent resonators is defined, and tapping in and out is defined, and every little piece is defined here. And that allows us to give a first pass simulation of what this filter is going to look like. So here you can see this dashed line. It may be kind of hard to see here, but it's got this really wonky ripple to it. And the return loss is really bad. This little grayed out dashed line is what we want based on our design goals. And this is what we're getting initially, not even close. So what I do is I set up these design goals in the optimizer. I say, tweak these things and go. And after playing with it a couple iterations and coaching it along the way, I'm able to tune in the response to the bold traces that you see here. And now my filter looks beautiful. It meets all the goals that I originally wanted to meet. So can we stop there? Unfortunately not. The closed form models are limited in what they account for. We now should graduate to the next simulator to see if there are any other unintended effects that are going to detune our structure. And you'll find that, in fact, they do. So now we're going to do some electromagnetic simulation, starting in axiom. Since this is a planar structure, we'll use axiom because it's a planar simulator. So it really leans itself well to this type of structure. And in AWR design environment, you'll find that moving from one type of simulator to the other is very easy. Once you have the closed form models defined, all you have to do is extract it out. Within a couple seconds, you're in a new simulator and ready to go. And here's what it looks like when I extract it out. And it basically takes those dimensions of the copper defined in the closed form models, and it creates the geometries with copper. Now, you see a lot of weird squares there. That's its version of meshing the structure. It's saying, I'm going to break down this big problem into these smaller pieces. And I'm going to solve the equation for these smaller pieces and the interaction between adjacent pieces and figure out what's going on here. So if there's coupling occurring here or here, which I didn't account for in the models, it'll now pick up on those sort of things. And sure enough, it did. As you can see, my nice tuned filter in Microwave Office, the closed form simulator, now is way off. It's ripply again, but not only is it ripply, it's now moved up in frequency. It's not working like it. I wouldn't build this. This isn't working like I intended it to be. I need it to work here. So obviously there were several unaccounted effects that weren't taken into consideration that had a profound impact on our filter. And that's why it's really important to use a variety of simulation tools, including electromagnetic analysis for these sorts of designs. So we see this problem. Now what are we going to do about it? How can we tune it? Well, similar to what I did in microwave office, we could use a direct parameter sweep where I say, touch these things and go. But because the simulation time is now longer on the order of something like 5 minutes, if we're going to work through 5,000 iterations, the time stacks up pretty quickly. So it's not always practical to have an electromagnetic simulator do that kind of brute force analysis. So what I'm going to show you today is this reverse correction factors method that I learned on the job that you can use to tune the design a little more quickly. And just a comment as coming out of school and directly into industry, one nice thing is you find there's a lot of people around you that have worked for more years than you've been even in school, or you've been alive sometimes. And they have a lot of knowledge that they are always willing to share with you. And I found that in where I work, and it'll be common in a lot of places you work, there will always be people who want to help teach and coach you. So this, among other things, are things that I learned on the job. I learned about filters, and I knew the fundamentals of how filters worked and how you could come up with filters from a table. I didn't know very much about what a distributed filter even was. I didn't know certainly how to design one. I learned these things on the job. So it's important to know that you don't always have to know everything before you start a job. I've learned more in the past 4 years on the job, or just as much in the past 4 years on a job as I did 4 years in school. The important thing is that you know your fundamentals well, and you can build then upon those fundamentals in your job based on the areas you're working in. So I'm going to show you one little thing that I learned, a trick that I would have never learned in school, to create a design like this. So it's something called the reverse correction factors method. Don't worry so much about the numbers shown here, but I'm going to show you what I'm doing with those numbers. So here's the dimensions of the filter from the initial microwave office closed form simulator design. This thing was tuned up and it looked good. What I then found is Axiom, the EM simulator, was off. So what I do is I go back to microwave office and I intentionally detune my filter to match the now detuned Axiom. So I'm intentionally destroying my microwave office design to match the wrong EM simulation results. I then find the difference in dimensions needed to do that, and I take a sign difference between them to come up with what I call a reverse correction factor. I then tag those reverse correction factors back onto the original values to essentially pre-distort my filter. So I know there's going to be a shift occurring. I figure out what dimension changes are needed to make that shift, and then I tack them back on in the reverse direction, so if I anticipate a shift, we'll hopefully be lined up when we simulate it. It's a little tuning trick that you can use when you have a simulator that takes a little longer to solve. So I'll show you what that looks like graphically here. Here is microwave office, and here is my bad Axiom electromagnetic. I basically need to detune this one intentionally to match up with the electromagnetic one. And so I do so, and you can see that now I got them to match up by intentionally messing with the different dimensions of the structure. The return loss also matches up. I come up with the reverse correction factors from that adjustment, and you can see that when I apply them to my filter, I'm essentially pre-distorting my filter now. It's now shifted lower because I'm anticipating that when I simulate it electromagnetically, it's going to shift back up again. And we'll see that, sure enough, it does. I then take that pre-distorted filter and I simulate it in the electromagnetic analysis tool Axiom, and I now meet my goals in the electromagnetic simulator. So basically that means in a simulator that takes in account all the effects, I now am meeting my performance goals. So I feel good about that. Since this is a planar structure, I could generally stop there, but I want to show you a little bit about a 3D simulator and what additional effects it could account for. And if you have a 3D simulator at your disposal, it's not necessarily a bad idea to take this planar structure and simulate it there, because who knows, there could be some other effects occurring that even that simulator didn't account for, even at least just for a sanity check. So before I'm moving on, I want to show you before. This is what Axiom spit out before tuning with reverse correction factors, and then afterwards it looks nice. It's tuned up. Here's the wide view of it in higher frequencies, and there's that notorious reentrant mode I was talking about. But for this design, I'm only worried about the second harmonic of a signal from 8 GHz passing through. So if this is better than 60 dB, which it is, I'm happy. If I was more concerned about this, we'd have to do different things in our system to take care of signals coming through there. So then I extract this to our 3D solver called Analyst. This is a top view of it, but if you were to rotate it, you could see that it is truly three dimensions. Now the mesh here looks more like a spider web. It's different than the other one, which was based of squares and rectangles. It essentially breaks up the structure into these little spider webby things. These are mesh cells, and it uses the geometry dimensions of your structure to determine how big these cells should be. It's going to use these cells to solve the same type of equations that Axiom used for the performance, except it's going to do it in three dimensions. So it's going to do the same thing to the air above it, the air below it, and everything around it. One thing that a lot of 3D solvers have that are really extremely handy is called adaptive mesh refinement. So it has intelligence in that it will take those mesh cells and it'll make them finer and finer and finer and finer until the resulting S parameters, the result frequency response of your filter, does not change within a certain accuracy. So if it makes something smaller and it sees a big change in your frequency response, it knows it needs to keep working in that area, and it'll make it smaller and smaller until your frequency response essentially settles out. So it tells you that you've meshed this fine enough to accurately simulate your structure within a given accuracy that you tell it. So it's a very handy tool in that it does it automatically, but as a result, it can take longer to simulate your structure because it has to go through this routine. But you know that you're getting very accurate results when you do so. So now I simulate the filter in Analyst, and you can see that without having to do any tuning, it lines up pretty darn well with Axiom. And that basically is a testament to it being a planar structure. There weren't a lot of 3D things going on that I expected to affect the performance of the filter. So the fact that they line up well makes sense. And since I'm still meeting my design goals, I'm deciding to stop there with the tuning. But I could essentially take the reverse correction factors method that I showed you earlier and apply it again and hone it in. If I didn't like this little expansion that I see there, I could do that. Now I have more confidence if I were to take this copper structure, build it on a printed circuit board, that I would more likely get the results that I want than if I were to start back with the iFilter or microwave office design. So as I mentioned, these two simulators can agree with each other because they're planar structures. But when do you use Axiom or when do you use Analyst? Well, if you're using a fully 3D structure, you know there's things going on in the Z direction that could hurt you, like a connector, for example, on the board. That's a truly 3D structure. Then you'll need to use a tool like Analyst to analyze it. But it'll also depend on the simulation time. So if you go to a full 3D solver, sometimes it'll take longer. Why would you use Analyst for a planar structure when you already have Axiom? Sometimes it's helpful just as a sanity check. If you can get two different solvers that solve the same structure in different ways and you can get the same result, then that's kind of a confidence builder that your design is probably working and that you didn't mess up a setting in one simulator versus another. Kind of a sanity check. So just to summarize, here are the three simulators, the tuned microwave office, the tuned Axiom, and the initial Analyst. And you can see that in all three simulators, I was able to get the performance that I desired. Same with the return loss. Now, I mentioned before that a disadvantage of some filters is that you have to ground them. Now, these ground connections, you're not simply just short-circuiting it to ground like you would in a normal circuit where you just make a connection with a wire. There's some sort of means to get to that ground reference plane. Oftentimes, it'll look like this cylinder, which is called a via, which is basically a tube of copper that makes a connection to those reference planes. Unfortunately, the bad news about those guys is they have their own parasitics, a lot like lumped element components. So it'll have an inductance and a resistance associated with it. It won't be an ideal ground connection. And you'll find at certain frequencies and for certain filters, the parasitics hanging off of your filter will actually detune your structure. So you need to take care in how you actually model these ground connections to make sure that your filter performs appropriately. So before wrapping up, I want to talk a little bit about PCB limitations. Since we're designing these things on printed circuit boards, they're not going to be perfect. I'm not going to build my tuned design and expect it to come out right on top of each other. There will be a lot of limitations that I have to live with within the process. So what are some of those limitations? The material that you're building it on has defined dielectric properties that basically say how it performs. Generally, the permittivity and loss tangent of a substrate will tell you how signals will propagate and with what properties. These need to be well known for your simulators, because something I didn't show here is if you're designing on a printed circuit board, you have to define what your printed circuit board is made up of. And that includes defining very well the properties of the structures. So if those aren't known well, you're going to design a filter in La La Land that is working in some other parameters that aren't true to life. So the more accurate you can get these models known, the higher your chances will be of designing that filter right the first time. There are also minimum dimensions. As I mentioned before, like with an edge-coupled filter, sometimes things can get too close together to be realizable. You'll find companies that build PCBs for you. They'll actually fabricate it and etch the copper on. They'll tell you generally that you can't get things closer to each other than 4 to 5 thousandths of an inch. If you go smaller than that, they're going to say they can't do that. So if your filter requires that, you may be stuck and have to go on to a different topology. On that note, there is also tolerances. So as with building anything, there's going to be variation in how it's built. So when they put the copper down, they're going to etch it away with an acid bath. And the amount of time that they let it etch away is going to tell you plus or minus how close you get to your dimensions. And they work really hard to bring that in tight. But they're going to tell you, well, we can guarantee within a certain number of standard deviations, you're going to have plus or minus half a mil on your widths and spacings. Depending on your filter, that could make or break you. There are also losses with components, and I won't go into much detail here, but your conductors aren't ideal. They're not going to conduct everything perfectly. They're going to have a loss associated to them, so you're going to also want to model that and take that into account. So as I mentioned, etching tolerances, what I did is I took our design filter and I entered in the etching tolerances from one of the PCB vendors we used. They said we have an expected amount of variation within one standard deviation of this amount. And I enter that into my tool and I say, okay, give me a Monte Carlo statistical analysis of how this filter would look statistically. And you can see the shaded areas are saying, well, within statistical probability of what you could get, this is how the filter would change if those dimensions change. So I can see, okay, I'm still meeting my goals. Even if the filter got a little bit wider or a little bit shorter, I would still be okay. But if you had a really narrow filter, sharp filter, or tight design requirements, this may break you. So you need to consider these things from the outset to make sure that you'd be okay in the end. Similarly, the Z direction changes, such as the printed circuit material that you use, can change a little bit. Even by things as small as a half a mil, plus or minus, which is half of a thousandth of an inch. And you can see that the filter will change based on those variations. So these are things that you want to take into account as well. Another thing that I learned on the job, these tolerances. You think you can design something, you come up with your values, I say the width of this thing should be 15.567 mils according to math. Well, you're never going to realize 0.567 mils in real life. You're going to get plus or minus 1 mil that's going to wash all that away. So it's another thing that I got to learn on the job is what are these tolerances of real world things when you actually go and do something that you have to take into account. And it's an important part, because then when you get your designs back and they all don't work, you'll know why. So I'm going to wrap this up by going through a much shorter design example of a different type of filter. It's the squiggly guy I showed you earlier. And we're not limited to designing bandpass filters. We can also design low-pass filters. And I'm going to show you a different type of procedure that we can take an already designed lumped element filter that you designed somewhere else and transform each piece as you move along into the distributed counterparts. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to essentially look at my already designed lumped element filter, which is pretty easy to do quickly in Microwave Office. I'm going to start with the last one, and I'm going to plop down a model for the distributed counterpart, which is a thin trace. I know that already from circuit theory. I'm going to then twiddle the dimensions, the width and the length of this thing, until the response of this thing matches that thing closely on the Smith chart at the corner frequency. So I'm going to adjust that until they have a similar behavior in the frequency domain. I'm going to then lock those dimensions down and move on to the next component. I'm going to tag it on. I'm going to add the radial stubs, which I know to be the shunt capacitors. And I'm going to wiggle that thing around until they land close to each other on the Smith chart. I'll go piece by piece down the filter until they match up. And now I've just transformed my lumped element filter into a distributed type filter. And there it is. This is an analyst. And those are the inductive components. Those are the capacitive components. And those are our little resonators that we're tagging on. And it's a little dark in this picture. It's just the shading of the tool. You can see a lot of little mesh cells. And again, it looks like a giant spider web. This is after adaptive mesh refinement. And what's interesting is you can see bigger cells out where nothing really interesting is happening. Here, we're not near the filter. We're on the ground plane. It knows it doesn't need to solve more equations here to get the right response. But you can see along these edges that it gets very hairy. It added a lot of really tiny mesh cells. It knows that there's a lot of very interesting electromagnetic things occurring there. So it meshes it finely to solve these structures better. And here's our response. This is my tuned microwave office response and my analyst response. And you can see, again, it's a planar structure. It was modeled very carefully, and the response looks pretty good. So to wrap it up, what did we talk about today? We talked about distributed element filters and how they compare to lumped element filters and why you would use one. We also talked about the advantages and disadvantages of using printed circuit board materials and how these tolerances need to be considered from the outset of a design in order to be successful. And in reality, oftentimes when you build something, things oftentimes don't work on the first revision. You'll get it back, you'll measure it, and you'll think, oh, it's not quite right. But what you do is you learn from that, you feed that information back to your simulator, and you refine your models so that you get better and better each time, so that you can have higher success the next time you build something. And that's oftentimes why prototypes are very handy, because you get the opportunity to do this little test run before you build the final thing. I also showed you how a simulation tool can be used to do your job. And this is commonly what you'll see in industry. You won't be writing on pieces of paper solving equations to come up with your filter. It's just too time consuming and prone to errors. Instead, you use simulators that do the math for you, and you still have to have knowledge of electromagnetic analysis and the theory of how these circuits work. It doesn't mean you don't have to know what you're doing. You still have to know very well what to touch, what to tweak, and how these circuits are working, but it speeds up your job so you can do more things better. At the end of the presentation, you'll see that I have some references. If you get the soft copy, you can refer to these if you're interested in learning a little bit more about these filters. And I had some advanced topics at the end in case anyone wanted to talk afterwards. But did anyone have any questions for me?
Yeah, two short questions. Number one, when this filter is put in a system, and then you have, components or devices and so on added to the beginning, to the input and output of that, how would this simulator, can you include these things in the simulator?
You can, and oftentimes you'll find that when you're designing these filters, you're assuming a 50-ohm environment, which is a system where there's no reflections occurring. Sometimes if you put these bad impedances at the input and output of your filter, it can actually detune it and mess things up. So, like you were saying, sometimes accounting for what you hook up to these filters can be important. Also, you want to see if these filters are helping those components in whatever way. And in this simulator, what you can do is you can actually take models for those components and attach them on. The filters that we design essentially become a sub-circuit in the circuit in the simulator with ports, and you then attach on the other pieces in your system, and you can run a higher level simulation to show how it all looks cascaded together.
And then the second question that I have is that when this filter, finally is put in the real system, the temperature is going to go higher or lower there. And then this temperature difference, which is going to basically affect the PCB, thickness and so forth, how would you basically take care of this in the simulator?
So you mean as a printed circuit board is operating in a normal operating environment with temperature fluctuations? This is a little harder thing to account for in a simulator because different kinds of components can vary differently. So with the case of a printed circuit board, you would have to communicate with the vendor, how would I expect my dimensions to change, expand or contract over temperature? You could then feed those variations that you could expect to see back into your simulator to see what kind of variations you could see. Some more advanced finite element analysis tools will actually do thermal simulations, where if you enter in the thermal properties of the materials, which again you have to talk to the vendor to get, it can break down the structure very similarly with the spider web meshes and simulate how it responds thermally to stimulation. And you could actually do a co-simulation thermally and electrically. Those are generally very advanced, very expensive simulators. Usually for a first pass, it's better just to get variation information from the vendor and then bring it back into your simulator and see how your circuit responds to those types of changes.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
How quick was it to learn these three different simulations?
Well, it took time. It helped that I had used similar tools in college. So making the jump was not too difficult to the closed form simulator. I was already familiar with that from different projects I had done. But the electromagnetic simulators I had never used before. So it took time, and the managers in charge of me understood that there was some learning curve with it. Those help files that I referenced before are invaluable for learning how to run these tools. A lot of people don't refer to them, and they'll just dive in and start clicking buttons and doing stuff. So if you read through those files and read certain areas, it really breaks it down. And what I found really valuable when you're learning a tool, especially a simulator, is oftentimes they'll come with examples. The vendor of that simulator will release examples. They'll say, this is an example amplifier and how you would design it and simulate it. You can open that project and play around with it and say, this is how it's supposed to look. Let me try doing that in my design. So learning by example is a really common thing to do. So, you know, it takes time, and I'm still learning things about these simulators. I haven't learned all there is. They're so in-depth. There's so many settings you can adjust, and they all react differently to different types of structures that you'll never fully learn how to 100% use the structure, even the people who make the tool. There's just so much it can do. It's so powerful. Yeah?
So when you have a design finalized, do you manufacture in-house, or do you ship it to somebody else to do that?
Well, it depends. At our company, for these sort of designs, we will ship out the printed circuit board information to an external vendor we call a fabrication house. We give them the files and say, these are what our copper layers look like, build it, and they'll say, okay, we'll do that. They build the circuit boards and they send it back. If we're going to put components on it, like those lumped element components, we'll do it in-house, where we'll actually solder those to the board. But the generation of these PCBs will be outside.
Okay. And how important is the control impedance of the PCB?
It can be very important. So those distributed structures, those widths were selected because they represent a certain impedance to the system.
Yeah.
If those widths change, the impedance changes and your circuit changes. So it really comes down to the tolerances of your process. And can you live with those sorts of changes? As you saw the filter expand and contracting with the etching tolerances, that was it responding to those impedance changes as it was doing that. So you have to really spend a lot of time understanding what the vendor is capable of and what they'll do for you so that you can make sure your design works when you actually build the thing. Yeah.
Do you always use a homogeneous material for your PCB substrates, or is there any benefit to layering it with like different index of refractions? Or?
Well, you know, with PCB material, oftentimes you'll find for RF and microwave designs, there's generally a few types of good materials that you know to go to. You say, there's this substrate, Rogers 4350, or Panasonic Megtron 6, which sounds like a transformer. And you use those materials, and you build those things, and they have these properties. And you generally just use those. You don't have to go to fancy things like that, and sometimes your design won't even work under those conditions. But some simulators can account for more unique, advanced materials if you have the characterization information on it. If you're curious how it works, you could enter that information and try it out. But generally, we just use more straightforward materials that we know to work well for RF designs.
So flex board doesn't ever come up?
Flex boards, it's harder to design RF microwave circuits on flex boards because as you flex it, it kind of changes. For my thesis, I actually, in college, I designed a microwave antenna on a flex circuit because it was wrapped around a missile. So it had to be circular. But I found that when I measured the antenna flat, it worked one way. When I wrapped it around, it moved. So I had to tune it again after wrapping. What's nice though is in the finite element analysis simulators is I could have wrapped it if I had access to a simulator before building it and accounted for it beforehand. So it's possible, but generally you don't see RF circuits designed on flex material because the substrates don't exist for the right properties. Any other questions? Oh, thank you for your time.
I would like to thank Drew for giving us such an excellent, instructive lecture. Really, I enjoyed it and I learned a lot. And I bet you have all learned a lot out of it. And then basically he shared his experiences with us and then the type of things that, you know, what he has learned in the school and then how we applied it in the job. Thanks again.
Thank you.
And let's give him another one.